Mr. Joe Hall. Joseph Lorenzo Hall is the Chief Technologist and Director of the Internet Architecture Project at the Center for Democracy and Technology, a Washington, D.C.-based nonprofit advocacy organization dedicated to ensuring digital rights and that the internet remains open, innovative, and free. Hall's work focuses on the intersection of technology and law, policy, and working to ensure that technical considerations are appropriately embedded into legal and policy instruments. You can hear those babies. Prior to joining the Center for Democracy and Technology in 2012, Hall was a postdoc fellow with Helen Nissenbaum at NYU, Ed Felton at Princeton, and Deirdre Mulligan at UC Berkeley. He received his PhD in information systems from the UC Berkeley School of Information in 2008. We are so proud of Joe. He's out there doing exactly what the ISO stands for. His PhD thesis used electronic voting as a critical case study in digital government transparency. And Joe has just told me that he is actively at work on voting machines at this very time. Joe is really a model of the kind of contribution that ISO graduates around the world are making. With no more ado, I'm going to welcome Joe Hall to the stage.
Thank you, Dean Saxenian, and thanks to the members of the iSchool faculty and the iSchool class of 2018 and all our guests here today. I'm really honored to be speaking to you all and so happy to see my alma mater in such a vibrant and rich school of information. All of you graduating today and completed degree programs that you should be really, really proud of. This is amazing. And there's so many of you. It's like, I think, two or three times as many as we had 10 years ago when I graduated. Take a moment to reflect on the things you know and you didn't know before you got here. Relationships and yes, that I know if you take my slide, those of you who aren't done yet, just stick in there for a long journey and it gets better. I'm going to start with a quick apology. Many of our guests in the audience, family and friends, are not going to have any clue what I'm talking about or some of what I've talked about here. And I'm sorry, but if you come find me or anyone else, we're happy to explain this kind of stuff. This problem, you know, where we're talking in geek terms or nerd terms is a problem that many of the graduates today face quite a bit. It's so easy to sort of breast the geek out, as we say, on these technical topics, and people around us think that we're speaking in a foreign language or in code, and sometimes we are. And I tried to think of a good example of this, so I'm gussing this up just a bit. I've enriched it just a little bit, and don't get mad if you say something like, you'd better HTTP this. You better HTTPS that thing, lest adversarial ML inputs corrupt your blockchain commits and fundamentally undermine your UX. Therefore, we all have to worry about post-quantum resistance to asymmetric crypto primitives, or even a sudden crypto apocalypse. So all your parents and friends probably understood very little of that. Maybe you guys got a feel for that. So just explain, just accept my apologies that we're going to geek out a little bit. Anyway, so I graduated 10 years ago. In fact, it's almost exactly to the day. It's actually 1 week, 10 years minus 1 week, would have been next week for the PhD students. I actually got my lollipop later that year, so what can we say? My thesis involved hacking voting machines, and I'll talk a little bit about that later. I'm happy to talk about that if you find me later, too. But so much has happened in the last year. A little bit of this is going to be somewhat U.S.-centric, so I apologize beforehand. And over the last 10 years, the United States has gone into and emerged from a recession, a housing crisis. We elected our first black president. We also elected our first orange president. Good. On a personal note, something that has shaped me quite literally is that I've been hit by cars twice over the past 10 years. I don't recommend that at all. There are other ways to learn that the US health insurance system is awful. Therapists and nurses are basically angels. And you may look pretty cool and all black like you guys are today, but just ask yourself how many people show up to the afterlife decked out in reflective gear. It's probably a smaller number than those dressed in black. So I have just one piece of advice: stay away from what I call involuntary body modification. Okay? After I graduated in 2008, and I'll explain a little bit of this, I did a postdoc jointly with Deirdre and Ed Felton at Berkeley and Princeton, and then Helen Nissenbaum at NYU. But I became frustrated by the academic job market. And for many of you, that it doesn't matter. But what matters is that I had to sort of think about what my goal in life was. And when it came down to it, I wanted to help you. Plain and simple, I wanted to help you. And while I enjoy research and teaching, I'm sure you guys get a feel for that in the program, I hope to get back to that someday, it made much more sense to stay away from industry or academia and then go into civil society or even the public sector and work with the governments. And so this is all to say that somewhere in this process, I found my calling, my avocation, so to speak, something that drives you beyond a mere career and occupation. I urge each of you to keep your eyes open and your ears open for when that might happen to you. It may not be very subtle in some cases, you may already know. For me, it was figuratively like getting hit in the face with a hammer when I realized, I was like, oh yeah, that's what I should be doing. And to put it simply, I really love translation, writ large. I enjoy facilitating understanding, taking something that is mysterious or magical, in sort of the Carl Sagan sense, if you know what I'm talking about, and make it tractable to people regardless of their background. I mean, really, compared to other things like general relativity, used to be an astrophysicist, none of this tech crap is particularly complicated at all. And my own life goal is to build a tiny technologist within each of you or everyone I can talk to. And I'm hoping that that little tiny technologist will grow in time so that we're all a little bit more comfortable with evolving the technical systems around us. But they're not going away, right? And technical literacy will increasingly differentiate those that can do things well and quickly from those that end up basically spinning their wheels and wasting time. And yeah, the world has changed a lot since 2008. Let me just give you a little bit of perspective here. In 2008, spring of 2008, the iPhone had come out 1 year before. Didn't have copy and paste, blows my mind. Didn't have GPS, it still was 2G. Barely think about that. In fact, I had to jailbreak my first iPhone to make field recordings of election recounts because the UX team at Apple thought that video was not ready for prime time. It was perfect for me. The latest iPhone, the one we're using these days, the iPhone 10, is quite different. It has a front-facing IR camera, an IR emitter that paints a matrix of 30,000 dots on your face to both model and verify your facial shape. And moreover, Apple, which is a shining example of a platform competing on privacy these days, they can ship a 3,000 dot subset of that facial matrix to advertisers and app developers, so a much smaller set of that face data. Why would they do that? Well, they want to be able to allow ads and customer interactions to skin avatars with your facial shape. And video game characters can look like you, facial tics and all. This is a short way of saying people with deep fakes are going to be a big deal, not just for sexy stuff. It's going to be a big deal for all sorts of things, right? This is just to remind you that the technologies that are taking baby steps today will be way beyond what we could imagine in 10 years. When one of you is up here in 2028 giving the commencement address to the students, it's going to look like you're in the Stone Age. Technologies that we're going to marvel at in 10 years in terms of how far they come are going to include autonomous vehicles, drone-based services, molecular printing, so 3D printing of very small structures, CRISPR gene editing, artificial intelligence of all flavors, cryptocurrencies and anonymous transactions, brain computer interfaces, and forms of what I have termed private computation, so things including differential privacy, anamorphic encryption, and secure multi-party computation. Some of you that go to some of these firms are going to be using this in real time in your jobs, and it's really cool. Let's just think just for a second about one of these things, brain computing interfaces, and one specific sliver of some of the things I care about when it comes to these things. Ask yourself, under what circumstances should a government be able to get access to data structures that are resident in your brain? I don't have any good answers, and that's one of many questions around this stuff. We're going to really think about these things and work them out. And the, oh, wait, But some of these innovations are going to protect us and help us do things, and some may increasingly expose us. And I really hope that reality isn't defined so much by who is first to market as it has been in the past 10 or 20 years. The worrying that startups do about shrinking runway is fundamentally about cutting corners, often, in my opinion. And many of you are going to make direct contributions to these kinds of technologies and these developments. Now, I'm going to end with a discussion about black boxes. My PhD work is all about black boxes. As I mentioned earlier, my PhD involved hacking voting machines. You may have heard that it's kind of a thing since 2016 in the United States. But actually, that's not exactly true. It wasn't about hacking voting equipment. It's just easier to say that than to say that I studied mechanisms for imposing transparency on black box systems used for government functions. These days, I have a lot of things I can point to rather than having to talk just about voting machines. I can point to the Volkswagen emissions scandal as a direct analogy. The call of Volkswagen vehicles were found to emit less under testing conditions using what is called a feed device, essentially a subsystem designed to allow the car to perform well and pollute more under normal driving conditions, but to reduce performance and emissions when it thought it was under an emissions test. Think about that, right? The company that claimed for many years to have remarkably low emissions is actually covered with books. Gee. Why? Because it's quite trivial for a vehicle to know when it's under testing conditions and emit less pollution. And that translates into mucho dinero, a lot of money. It's hard to believe that they didn't think they would get caught. After all, those vehicles were pretty good at cheating an emission test. It's not hard to do a performance evaluation, essentially attaching sensors on your exhaust pipe and driving around normally. But it's just one innovation away, so to speak, to add that cheating back. It's not hard to imagine a tailpipe sensor or something like that that modifies the engine performance if it detects something clamped to the tailpipe or something even slightly obstructing the exhaust flow. And so I'll end with a plea. Using black box systems to deceive, to hide important interactions, to obfuscate, I would argue is a real poor use of education we've all worked just so hard for over the past years. We spend so much effort making things seamlessly easy to use and abstracting away complexity that we forget that the interaction with an interface or a system is itself an opportunity to educate, to inform, and to enfranchise. So in this 150th anniversary year of UC Berkeley, the first of the UC systems, please keep in mind that the simple but powerful model of the UC system may guide you. Fiat lux, right? Let there be light. That's exactly the opposite of black box thinking, right? So I want to thank you for listening. Congratulations. Don't forget this whole information in future giving and estate planning.